Galatians part 7. And I've seen some stuff today. We'll go over here in a few minutes, but just kind of wowed me, I guess. But you know, we got to keep in mind the thought of Paul when he wrote this letter. Paul loved those Galatians, and he was declaring to them the reality of the gospel. So, at the beginning of the letter, when he says, Paul, an apostle, he is establishing his perspective. We went over that, his view. And that was from an inward work that was done in him. By the revealing of Christ, and a work that Paul abided in, that he walked in. And it's out from that which he ministers. And that has to be out from which anyone ministers, is out from that view. You know, like we was talking with Raven, nobody's called to preach. And, you know, we used to think we were. We're called into the fellowship, and out of the revealing of Christ we minister, but... And see, this is the foundation that Paul is upon when he is writing this letter to the Galatians. And that's the basis upon which this letter is written, or which all of Paul's letters are written. And Paul's view was the same view as the Father. And what the view of the Father was, beholding his Son, and the view of Paul, when it pleased God to reveal his Son in him, so he had the same view as the Father. And what Paul is doing here is setting the boundaries of our salvation. And you wouldn't believe just even in that term right there, setting the boundaries of our salvation. I want you to keep that in mind. Because salvation is an exclusive reality. What do I mean by that? Everything else is excluded except Christ. And in order to know anything of this salvation in which nothing is lacking. Now keep that in mind. Nothing is lacking of this salvation. And it's exclusive. In order to know anything, that very Christ must be revealed in our soul. And the more that he's revealed, the more our soul becomes engulfed in that very presence of the indwelling Christ revealed in us by the Father. And when this difference starts to come, I'm telling you what, guys, and you know this, when you begin to see Christ, it's not a small difference. It's the difference of, it's like two different worlds, two different creations, night and day, life and death, above and beneath. I mean, it's major. But what matters the most is what man is in view. And that's what makes it real. You know, we talk about reality. That's what makes it real, is having the proper man in view. And until the proper man is in view, you can say the right words. You can read the Bible. Quote all the scriptures you want, but it's not the gospel. And it is not even the truth. Well, you don't know how many times people get up to read God's word. This is not God's word. God's word is a man. The truth is a person. These may be about the truth, but it's not the truth. And just reading him isn't truth. The gospel is the person of Christ. And that separation, that judgment between the two becomes greater and greater. Between what is Christ and what is not, just don't become what is not. It becomes what is accursed. You see what I mean? Because it's either in Christ or it's accursed. The wrath of God. You see what I mean? Because he's turned his back and God only views his son. Now, the gospel does not necessarily preach the effect or preach the result. We try to measure the gospel on its effects. And boy, I know about that. That's how we would used to look up at a preacher, you know, how much he moved me. What was the effects that he preached? You know, if I was moved a whole lot, it was the gospel. If I wasn't moved. But also, looking at this from another viewpoint on the effects, the gospel is not declaring to you the effects of what will take place at the revealing of Christ. The gospel is the declaration of the reality, the spiritual substance that he has come in us. The gospel declares if you are to know the salvation you have received, the one who was promised is now come in you. By grace. And see, the gospel leaves the heart with one expectation. You see, under the old, they had an expectation of a coming Messiah. But now the preaching of the gospel should leave you with one expectation. Turn to see him. Any other expectation is false and it's accursed. You must see him, and that leaves the effect between your soul and the Spirit of God. What I mean by the effect. Well, go with me to Ecclesiastes. And chapter 3. Because remember, the gospel declares the fullness. There's nothing lacking. Christ in you. And you remember what Paul wrote in the fullness of times? Let me just read that scripture real quick. It's in Ephesians. You know it, and we've went over it many times. But that in the dispensation or the administration of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ. Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. Go and read the next verse. It was predestinated. It was predetermined. The boundaries were predetermined. They were preset there in Christ. But now he's gathering all these times up. Now you know these scriptures here, but I'm going to tell you what. This is what the seeing of Christ does in the soul. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born. Think of this not just like how we've always looked at it, but this is out from the revealing. This is what takes place in a soul upon the revealing of Christ. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant, a time to pluck up that which was planted. Think about that. Because remember I told you the effects? Paul's not preaching the effects here, but right here we have the effects because everything that's been planted, then we begin to see Christ and there's a great judgment. And then everything was planted begins to be plucked up. We see we're dead. And we see that Christ lives in us. A time to kill. A time to heal. A time to break down. A time to build up. Do you see all these contrasts? A time to weep. a time to laugh, a time to mourn, a time to dance. All of this is coming out from this judgment of the revelation of Jesus Christ. A time to cast away stones. A time to gather stones together. A time to embrace. A time to refrain from embracing. A time to get, a time to lose, a time to keep, a time to cast away. A time to rend, a time to sow. Time to keep silent, a time to speak, a time to love, time to hate, time of war, time of peace. What profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen their travail which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. I'm just thinking of that scripture in Hebrews that he had his senses exercised thereby. This is what takes place. This ain't just, you remember, we just read in Ephesians, he would gather all them times in Christ. And of course, those times was all the times he was given to Israel. But that's the fullness of time, the reality of the cross that has been brought in. That's the finished work that's been brought in, the fullness that all the time spoke of, which is Christ himself. And there will always be a judgment taking place in the soul that is constrained in the very view, in the viewing of the Lord. The love of Christ constraineth us. Those judgments right there will always be, those are the effects. And I'm going to get to something here in a few minutes, and just when you think, wow, you know, you're getting a good handle on it, you see something else. And then these judgments come in, and then there's, it's almost like, you know, oh man, it's a time to mourn. The gospel may not declare what the effect will be, but it declares to you the source of it. Seeing him. Paul declares the fullness. And then what was his prayer? You know, and I think about that, how much simpler my prayer life has become. If you want to call it my prayer life, but my prayer has become. Really, it's just as Paul's prayer there in Ephesians. I pray that the eyes of your understanding may be enlightened. Paul never said what would happen, the effects. You're just going to know, and the knowing of the reality brings the effect. These things we just read here. The beholding of him brings the effect. All else being shut out of your view. Being shut out, excluded. Remember we was talking about the exclusivity of Christ. And all else is excluded, displaced by the period of the fullness that he is in you. I mean, think about all these times. I mean, you know, plucking up and breaking down and weeping and casting away and all those from that side. Because when he comes in view, the fullness that he is in you. What most of the church world, most Christians think today, that something is lacking or something is missing. And the church still says one day it will be perfect. What is lacking in our thoughts has nothing to do with his fullness. It does not diminish his, you are complete in him one bit. If you are in Christ, you are in the sphere, in the realm of fullness. That's hard to comprehend. And you know what? We'll be eternity comprehending. We are brought into a whole nother world. Brought into the kingdom of his dear son. See, salvation is that sphere of Christ himself, and it's exclusive. He doesn't come to enhance your viewpoint. He comes to destroy it with himself. Fullness isn't missing, but most people think it is. And I'm going somewhere with this. Because I know all my life I was waiting, doing everything that I could do, doing everything I was told to do, and even trying to go a step farther. So it's not fullness that you need. It's not perfection that you need. You have all that. What is lacking? Light. Think about the scriptures. Walk in the light. See, that's why he would tell them, awake, 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 O sleepers, awake, you're children of the day. And in the day that he is, you can read it in Revelation, there's no night at all. He's the light thereof. There's no darkness at all. There's no sun, no moon. We need light in order to see the Lord who is present and to know him as he is. See, I imagined what he was on my life. I'm sure you guys did too. What he looked like, how he would talk to me. And I was free to do so. I was free to imagine what the Lord was. And I'm going to tell you something. One of the most famous Christian songs out is what? I Can Only Imagine. So it is propagated in the church to use your imagination to think of what it's going to be like. Sing songs about it. Imagine it. But I'm going to tell you, that's all the natural mind can do. That's all religion can do, is conjure up imagination. And the thing is, it's a vain imagination based on man's vain thoughts. Religion has made, tried to make God in their own image. You know, and Raven went over that so well, talking about when Moses went up on a mountain and delayed, and they couldn't see him anymore. So as soon as they couldn't see him, they made them a God that they could see. So here we have, that's why we have so many different denominations, because nobody sees the Lord, so they have an imagination of what he is, so we create a denomination based on my imagination. Here's what you got to do to be saved. Well, here's what grace is. Here's what this is. Here's what this is. But see, there's a casting down of imaginations in every high thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. When does that take place? In the appearing of Christ. That's what Paul is fighting for here in the Galatian church. He's not telling them they don't have salvation. He's not saying you haven't come by the grace of God. You haven't been brought into Christ. You haven't been brought into that sphere of grace, which Christ is. He's saying you are removing yourself from that grace. He's telling them you can't experience this salvation because you are stepping outside of the borders, stepping outside of the exclusivity of Christ, and are attempting to find something of spiritual significance outside of him. You know, I think about these little words, you know, my church, my ministry, we're outside of Christ. But see, this salvation is exclusive. It is called Christ all and in all. Full, complete. I mean, he's the Alpha and Omega. How could we think there would be something beyond him? I mean, if you think about that, I mean, Christ plus nothing. How could we think that there is going to be something outside of Christ or something beyond Christ? I mean, how could we think something beyond his presence could be more perfect? What is more perfect than the presence of Christ? I mean, think about that. I mean, people don't even, one of these days I'm going to have my mansion and all this other stuff. What about the presence of Jesus Christ? They're not waiting on that. And see, that's what the church world needs. They're needing the expectation of the gospel. That's why Paul says that no other gospel that I preach than the one I preach. No other gospel. We're going to look at these verses. But see, the gospel is not synonymous with preaching. Preaching is not the gospel. Sermons are not the gospel. And, you know, that comes to the question, are we preaching the gospel? But as I said before, the gospel itself proceeds out of a soul that is beholding him who is the substance of the gospel. Who is the good news himself? What is the good news? What was it that they longed for? They long for a Messiah. And now Paul's telling them it's even better than we thought. We had no idea it would be this way. But it's even better now because it was veiled in a mystery. But the better part is we just don't have Christ with us, but we have Christ in you. Do you see the difference? People think they're preaching the gospel when they preach Christ and they preach in one glad day, but the gospel declares the good news of him who was promised of God. Now being present in your soul. The gospel, that's what the gospel declares. Anything else, it's not the gospel. That's the only gospel there is. And that gospel gives a true expectation, not another one. Not Christ and then another day. Not Christ and something else. Not Christ making me this. But Christ in his fullness. The gospel gives an expectation of, I must see him. You don't know how many times I went and just heard so much other stuff. Let me read you a little Galatians here in Galatians 1. I read verse 6 through 9. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, look, he doesn't even wait till the end of the letter to say it again. As we said before, so I now say again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. These are strong words. And why? Because it's, now you see why it's so important to understand the perspective out from which Paul is speaking. Paul's soul has come to the singleness, to the simplicity, to the exclusiveness of Christ. So anything outside of that, he's telling them it's another gospel that you're being led away. But he said it's not even another gospel. And anything outside of this, let it be accursed. Because Paul knew there was nothing else. We were talking about this a little bit before. That's why Paul would say, in Philippians, to be found in him, not having mine own righteousness. But think about this. What Paul is really saying is to be found in him, having nothing of my own. Only that by faith I lay up hold of him to be made unto me. And what is that? Seeing faith, we know faith is beholding Christ. Paul says, not as though I'd already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I might apprehend that for which I am also apprehended of Christ Jesus. That I might lay hold of that I've already been apprehended, that I might comprehend what he's saying. He's talking about this gospel. Now I want you to just think about it. To be found in him, not having anything of my own. Now I'm going to tell you what, guys. When I hope I can lay it out the way I see it today. But it was just so devastating to me. Because I seen something, you know. I told Olga, it's one of them gut punches, you know, that just kind of come around every so often. And it just... You know, that's one of them times you just kind of sit back. And, you know, it's one of them times you just kind of shake your head. My goodness gracious, you know. Look here in Romans. Romans chapter 16. Verse 25. Now to him... That is a power to establish you. To establish you. Now think about this. To establish you. To bring you into some sureness. Into some stability. How? According to my gospel. And what is that? The preaching of Jesus Christ. And how is that? According to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. He tells you what the gospel is. It comes out from the revelation of Jesus Christ. And then he's telling them in Galatians, whatever I attempt to add to that, by whatever means I try to add to that, let it be accursed. Let it be accursed of God. It's death. I'm trying to bring in death if I try to add anything to it. Walking contrary to what he has established in the person of his son. And see, all the time I've been doing what I was told. Doing everything religion said. Reading and praying and fasting and doing all those things. And now I'm telling you what, guys, when you see something, and now that just brings so much other things in view, you know, in view. I just think today even about fasting and all those things that we have done. But see, all those things that I'm trying to bring in, it's all short of the glory of God. And we know what that is. That's sin. And at the time we're doing that, we're missing our salvation. We're not experiencing our salvation. Yes, you're saved, but you don't experience that salvation that you have. And you cannot experience that salvation until that single, exclusive object, the person of Christ, appears in your view. And then there's only one cry from your soul from that point on, to know him. Come see a man. You know, I always wondered what he told her. But then I seen that when Raven was talking about it, you know. Queen of Sheba come to prove him with hard questions. She come to see if he measured up. But when she came before Solomon, she didn't ask him any questions. There's not recorded one single question that she asked, because when she saw him, she saw the answer to her heart's desire. That's what this woman at the well said, come see a man that is the answer to everything. That's what she's telling him. Come see a man that told me all things. In other words, come see a man who is the answer of it all. Paul says here, this is according to something. It wasn't according because I got a Bible and I went to seminary. Now I can preach and now this is my gospel. There was an element necessary here. It was according to the revelation of the mystery. The preaching of the gospel is the declaration of the present indwelling Christ, being made into his body all that he is. Because of that, therefore, the gospel directs the soul to the proper object of seeking. Now, I'm telling you a lot of this thing. It brings in this expectation. And it declares the only true basis for seeking God. Declares only one basis. Union with his Son. Union with the Son of God's satisfaction. You've been brought into the Son in whom God is well pleased. Most seek God in view of the fact they think God is angry. I mean, why did you come to salvation? You know, most of us were, for whatever reason, we're scared into it, thinking we're going to hell or whatever. You know, nobody ever declared the state that we were in. We were already dead, cut off from God. No hope. That was the situation we were already in. It wasn't me waiting on a day to get cut off. We already were dead in trespasses and sin. That was the state we came into this world in from our mother's womb. Nobody ever declared that to me. But then people start telling me, well, one of these days you're going to go to hell. And I'm thinking, well, you know, heck, who cares about that? You know, I got right now, so, you know. But they see, they view God from that God is angry, that God is not satisfied. Why? Because they see my lack. So we began to pray. And how many of these prayers have you prayed? God make me, oh, I know I have. God make me to be a better person. God make me to be a better dad. God make me to be more loving. God make me to do this. God make me to do that. Think about what Paul says, to be found in him not having anything of my own. Be praying, and you know, looking around and knowing truly in my heart. And see, this is a great judgment that comes in because we can play the church game. I knew how to play it well. Oh, we gotta love everybody. I can just remember that. We gotta love everybody. I can remember that hearing that so many times and how hard I tried, but the harder I tried, I knew there was people I despised. And then other people I didn't even care about. I didn't hate them. I didn't love them. You see what I mean? They were just people that I passed in the store, in the aisle. They was of no concern. And I used to get condemned in myself thinking, God, if you could just make me so that when I walk in Walmarts, I could be the Savior that everybody's looking for. I could be the smile. I could be everything. God, because see, we come praying in a view of lack. And we think, oh, that's okay. That's just ignorant. Well, it was. See, we seek God based on that because that's what we hear. We hear, this is God's destiny for you. Now, if this is God's destiny for you, it automatically presupposes that you're not there. So there, it automatically says there's a lack. I mean, if people will listen to the preachers on TV who says, God is about to do this, that means your state of being right now, the way they're preaching it, is not perfect. And God is about to do something for you. See, we've already cut the gospel off. We've already took them out of the sphere of you are complete in him, lacking nothing. And you know, I just got these names rolling around in my head, and 33,000 people sitting there on TV tonight while one is telling them about their destiny. And I know why. I've seen why they go there. I've seen why. They're saying God has not yet supplied you with something. Can you imagine that? I mean, what kind of person is that? You know, and I just go back to them scriptures, you know, with what the Lord says, you being evil, know how to give good gifts, how much more your Father. So we got a Father, God in heaven, who's up there saying, you know, Olegay, one of these days I'm going to do this for you. You know, it'd be like Bev telling her kids, you know, one of these days I'm going to fix y'all a big meal. One of these days I'm going to feed you. You know, that is stupid. He has provided everything and so much more in His Son. But they see the lack. And see, that is not the gospel upon which God can establish you. Because we talked about that He, that is a power to establish you. Him establishing you on, He can't establish you on something He's yet to do. The gospel says, see Him, only Him. Here's a verse in Galatians 5. Think about this. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us, not set us, made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. What is the yoke of bondage? Well, even us great grace preachers will say, well, that's law, that's Ten Commandments. We're not under that anymore. We're going to just see how deep-rooted these things are. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he's a debtor to do the whole law. And Christ is become of no effect unto you. Even though you are brought into the sphere of Christ, brought into the kingdom, Christ has no effect. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. Now, boy, oh boy, isn't that a term for backslide? See, I can remember when I was baptized, I can remember walking out the dirt road out from the river, the Clinch River at the mill dam up there where I was baptized. Walking, there was 13 of us baptized that day, and I remember walking out with this guy named Alan, and me and him swearing, walking out the road, we're never going to backslide. Didn't have a clue what backsliding was. And then when I thought I was backslidden, but then when I came back into the church, I thought I wasn't backslidden anymore, and come to find out that's all I was doing, was trying to go back under those things and be, by my own works, be pleasing to God, to get God's attention, to be God's satisfaction. But now He says this, for we through the Spirit wait for the hope, for the expectation of righteousness, how? By faith. What is that? We wait for that righteousness that we're going to see when we see Him. He's telling these Galatians, you've stepped outside of the boundaries. I've stepped outside of the boundaries, and I think I can do it from here. Think about what I'm just telling you. God, if you will just help me to be a more loving person, if you'll change me and get me going in the right direction, then I can do it from here. I will serve you. Isn't that something? We've got to go serve God. You know, I'm serving the Lord. He has one who is ever serving Him. I'm going to live for God. You know, we've talked about this so many times. No, he doesn't want you to live for him. He has provided you with the life. He doesn't want yours. He's done away with yours at the cross. Why does he want your service? He doesn't. He has one. He has everything in his son. Service doesn't go in conjunction with rest. There therefore remaineth a rest to the children of God. There's only one life God accepts, and that's the one life God has given to you. By grace. Let me go back to Galatians here. Verse 7, which is not another gospel, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel. Galatians 1:7. They would pervert. That word pervert means to change into the very opposite. It means to misdirect. It also means to turn you from the proper object. To turn something to its opposite. Give you an example, would be like turning the sun dark. You remember Isaiah said they will, let me go get that out, Isaiah, so I don't misquote it. Isaiah 5:20, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, and put darkness for light and light for darkness. That put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to them. Let him be accursed is what Paul says. Let him be accursed. Paul's saying their desire, these Judaizers that's coming in, their desire among you is to pervert the gospel. But see, here's what Paul is saying. You can't pervert the gospel. It's established. It's perfect. It's eternal. It's complete. But you can redirect the heart of those who hear to another object. And that is the perversion. Directing their heart to another object. Think about the perversion today. That not another gospel says it's you living for God. It's you serving God. And here's the kicker. Christ is the means by which you do that. Christ is there to help you make God happy. It's perversion. Here's how Paul said, I live unto God in Galatians 2:19. He says, for I through the law am dead to the law. Paul tried to live for God. He was zealous, more zealous than all the others. Read more, studied more, done more. He tried to live for God. We see what that got him in Romans 7. But Paul says, I found no rest there. But he makes this statement, for I through the law am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. How does Paul live unto God? I am crucified with Christ. Paul says, I'm never going to be found as one living unto God. Here's how I live unto God. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth unto God in me. Do you see that? That's how Paul lives unto God. Christ liveth in me. Paul found no rest in trying to live for God. But he says there, but when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb, we're going to look at all that, to reveal his son in me, why? That I might preach him. Paul said, he revealed him in me as everything. See, the gospel does not promise man a spiritual fullness. You wouldn't believe how I wanted all that spiritual fullness. And I thought that's what the gospel was. Tell me what I'm going to get. The gospel proclaims Christ in you as spiritual fullness. He must be revealed. You see, only one eternally satisfies the heart of the Father, and he lives in you. So what's the perversion? It brings you back into the picture. It makes you the object of God's desire. Now, can you imagine what's being preached? Oh, here is your destiny, and this would make God so happy if you would fulfill the plan that God has for you. That is a perversion, and Paul says, let it be accursed. But now, here's the other side. When I say it brings you back into the picture, it makes you the object of God's desire. And if not in a good way, then it makes you the object of God's anger also. That's what people think. That's what I was telling Olga before we started. If you cannot do anything to make God satisfied, what can you do to be the object of his anger? Nothing. The only thing that you can do is remove yourself. And see, when you remove yourself outside of the realm of Christ, you go back into a realm that's already been judged, adjudicated, separated from God. And what is in that realm? Weeping, wailing, gnashing of teeth, darkness. He doesn't have to. He's already judged that. And you want to go back to that because he says that's all there is. There's either life or death. There is not middle ground. You're either in Christ or you're dead in trespasses and sins. I mean, what does he say? What does he tell Abraham? Lift up now thine eyes from where? I love that little part. From where you are. He's not bringing you to someplace else, but establishing you. Remember that he's able to establish you. He's establishing your soul where your soul is, in Christ. And if you will set your heart to look, he shall appear. The gospel proceeds and stands on absolute perfection. All things are complete and finished in Christ. And Christ in you is the substance of that finished work. He is in you as the delight and the satisfaction of the Father. The gospel does not bring the accursed man back into view. Remember how he appears unto salvation without sin? It never declares a sinner getting better. It's not a spiritually enhanced natural man. This is a new creation. And the gospel declares the only man that remains. Christ in you, the fullness, the glory expected or hoped for. And, you know, we got to read a couple of these verses here in Colossians 1 and 23. Remember, he's able to establish you. Then Paul says here in 1:23 of Colossians, if you continue in the faith. Now what is he saying if you continue in the faith? Well, you know, I'm going to church all the time. No! If you continue with your eyes fixed on him, that's faith. You see what I mean? If I continue with my eyes fixed on him, then what's he say? Grounded and settled. So think about that. Rest is what he's talking about here. Rest, grounded, settled. Rooted, established. And then he says, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, from the expectation, which ye heard and which was preached to every creature, whereof I, Paul, have made a minister. See, your expectation as a believer is based upon what they expected under the old covenant. And what they expected under the old covenant was Christ, a Messiah. But Paul is saying it is fulfilled. I mean, look what he says in 1:27. To whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. Everything they hoped for. And see, they didn't even know. They thought it was going to be a king like David. They had no idea it was going to be far greater, a greater than Solomon is here, before Abraham was I am, and that man was going to live in them as everything, as the complete satisfaction of God, something they could not mess up. See, our expectation is not something other than our present state of being. It's directly connected to our present state of being. That Christ, and here's the expectation, that Christ who lives in us would appear. And I know for people that would think, well, you know, I don't like this present state of being, and you know, I don't like it. It's because you're viewing the wrong man. If that man would be made known in us, takes place in us. We don't look, once this begins to happen, you don't look anywhere else. The exclusivity of Christ. And then what happens? Those effects of those time, a time to pluck, a time to plant, you know, a time to cast down, to cast away stones. That all those times start becoming effective. I mean, how many things have I had to cast away and pluck up, tear down? And really, it's not you doing any of that. When he appears, you face the destruction of it. We must set our hearts to this reality. Christ in us. Christ, I mean, this effect happens when Christ is formed in you, and it's a judgment that takes place in you. And then you come to this conclusion. I don't know about you, but I've heard you guys say this before. Once you get a glimpse of him, then it becomes, it doesn't matter, Lord. Tear down, take away, destroy, do everything. I've got to see more of him. Nothing else matters. Big church, little church, who cares? I want to see him, you see. See, the gospel gives you the indwelling Christ as the only object to set your affection upon. No other object. No other waiting for some day or destiny or anything else. The gospel declares one expectation. Set your affection. I mean, God's satisfaction. God is pleased. Man, what a statement. Just to see that begin to settle in my heart. God is well pleased. Just come and see. Just turn. But here's the two terms that kind of devastated me today. The two terms, lust and affection. Now, both speak of a passionate pursuit. Now, remember, we're talking here in Paul's letters here. But these two terms they have opposing bases. And you can see that. And Paul's going to bring this one out that he calls, that is not another gospel. That has a different basis than the affections. I mean, look at this verse here in Colossians 1:25. Whereof I am made a minister, according to the dispensation, according to the administration of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. In other words, Paul is a minister of God's satisfaction. And here's something else. There could not be a new covenant if God wasn't satisfied. People don't even think about that. If God wasn't completely satisfied, there could not be a new covenant. See, the old covenant stood until the one that was well-pleasing, because he could never be pleased. He was never pleased with sacrifices and offering. Thou hast had no pleasure, but lo, I come. The volume of the book's written of me. Then he said, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. When he came, the other was done away, and now accursed. Why? Because it was not the Son. You see what I mean? So now this is exclusivity of the Son. The not gospel, the Paul says, which is not another gospel, when I say the not gospel, that's the one he's referring to, does not proceed out of the revealed Christ. It produces hearts that lust. And I know when I would read these, the lust of the flesh, boy, oh boy, oh boy. And you know, we're not going to go into every one of those. We will as we get on over in there. But that other gospel, which is not another gospel, produces hearts that lust. And I never seen, because I always took that lust. And you know, we have a negative connotation for it. And it sounds so degrading. How could any Christian lust? So what we do is we set ourselves up in self-righteousness and we say, you know, we're here producing the fruits of the Spirit, and these guys over here going to the bar rooms and shooting pool, they're all in the lust of the flesh. Paul's talking about these here in the Galatians, the Judaizers. And I'm going to show you what that is. See, most of my Christian life, I lusted after the things of God. You see, and lust is about passion, but it's the wrong motivation. It's the wrong foundation. And your seeking of God will always be in connection from where you see yourself to be, where you know you live, where you see your life. The other gospel, the non-gospel, is producing those who are lusting after the things of God, but not setting their affections to know the indwelling Christ as the all things of God. They are trying to fulfill the lust of the flesh, although they are in Christ. Now let me tell you, think about what I'm telling you here. I go to God praying with me in view. What do you see? Your lack. Paul says, I don't want to go having anything of my own. So automatically, it produces a lust in me for God to make me something when God has already given us Christ, who has made unto us all things. Can you see the difference? So here I am, in all my prayers, we wonder why our prayers wasn't answered, and he tells us, because you've got to consume them about the lust. Because you're wanting God to make you something when he's made Christ everything and given him to be your everything. Now see, when I had that today, I just had to go sit down a few minutes. Because I said, I've spent my Christian life in the lust of the flesh. I didn't even know what it was. I thought lust of the flesh was, I want a beer, or I want a woman, or whatever. I had no idea the lust of the flesh Paul is referring to was when I am trying to get God to make me something he's already made his son. The flesh is desiring a place that was never meant to be. But you see, that's what the other gospel does, because it comes out from a view of you seeing your lack. So it's may God do this for me, God do that. It's all a lust of the flesh. I mean, look what he says here in Galatians 5 and 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit. Walk with this view, and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh, because you'll see Christ is your all in all. And you won't see your lack, and you won't see your, I need this. If you walk in the Spirit, walk in the light. See, and then I turn on the radio and I hear about all this lack and all this, we got to do this and we got to do this. And I said, man, all of that is coming out from the lust of the flesh. And I've been there. But nobody ever declared truth to me so that I could turn and see. I'd never seen him, so I was always preaching from a view of lack, fulfilling the lust of the flesh. Lust is I am pursuing the things of God to apprehend those things which belong exclusively to Christ, to bring them to myself, to apply them to myself, and then they become my possession. Christ came to his own. He came to his own things. All the inheritance was his. It was all given to him. He owns it all. He is it all. But yet I want it for myself. And then we say, God, make me righteous. He's made unto me righteousness. Lust to obtain or become the one that pleases God. Now see, we did that with a sincere heart, didn't we? We wanted to be the ones that made God smile. And we had no idea. See, when you see Christ, that's why Paul could say, let it be accursed. He didn't come in there and say, oh, Patty, it's okay. He said, you don't know what you're trying to do because you've never seen him. Now, I'm coming in here with this gospel saying, let me tell you something. I'm preaching to you because I have seen him, and I'm telling you, you are bringing in the accursed thing. We try to desire to bring what is heavenly and spiritual into the earth and apply it to man and make it his possession, his acquisition. God made me this. God didn't make you anyway. God crucified you, and he made Christ to be all things unto you. And here's the lust. Again, man attempting to possess a relationship with God that he does not have. He wants it for himself. Why? Because it comes from the viewpoint of separation. You're called into the fellowship of his dear son. But when you don't see that fellowship, you will go about to establish your own relationship with God and try to maintain that relationship with God instead of Christ being all in all. And on the opposing end of that, we have the word affection. And that has to do with wanting to know or to apprehend the relationship that you already possess. And see, you can see that, you know, we can bring that over into the natural and like husbands and wives and their affections towards one another, or somebody who is a single and they're lusting after a woman because they see their lack of a relationship. You see what I mean? Paul, I mean, he says that, in, you know, here in Colossians. Seeing that you're already risen with Christ, set your affection there. Get to know this relationship. Get to know him to be everything in you that religious lust tried to be. Now I'm almost finished. See, affection is from a standpoint of fullness. It's from a standpoint of union. It's from a standpoint of completeness. And Christ and knowing him as its only goal. Paul says in Galatians 1:7, he says that they're perverting the gospel, and he says they trouble you. He said, I know that you have those that are troubling you. And what that means is they're confusing you. They're causing you not to rest. They're causing an inward commotion. But there's something else. He says they're subverting or corrupting the gospel. Now look what he says here in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 11. Verse 2 and 3. For I am jealous over you with a godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband. that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear, lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through the subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted or subverted from the simplicity, from the singleness, from the exclusivity that is in Christ. You won't find rest because you stepped outside of the realm where rest is found. And then look at verse 4. For if he that cometh preaches another Jesus, just like Paul said in Galatians 1, if they preach another gospel, whom we have not preached, or you receive another spirit which you have not received, or another gospel which you have not accepted, you might, he's telling them right here, you would probably receive that. You would receive that, but why? Because you're not established in the present truth. He said, I fear you're being beguiled just like Eve, and they're perverting the gospel, and they're troubling you, and you're not finding rest. You think God is angry and all these other things. Look what he says right here in verse 12. But what I do, that will I do, that I may cut off occasion from them which desire occasion. Same thing he's talking about here in Galatians. That wherein they glory, they may be found even as we. For such are false apostles. You know what an apostle was. It was sent that view. The view of the risen Savior. Deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. No marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. In other words, they want you to be the center of God's universe. Wasn't that what the subtlety was plumb back in the garden? You can be like God. But see, back over here in Galatians, now Paul understands it, but we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel. Paul understands the reality of God, and he doesn't want their confidence in him or an angel or anything else, or based on who's preaching, but based on the reality of the gospel. Preach any other gospel that goes beyond the limits, the borders, the boundaries of Christ. Transgresses the limits. Preach any other gospel. Any other. Now you remember how we started this whole thing out with the encampment and Balaam up on the mountain, and he says, what God has blessed, I cannot curse. Paul is telling them anything we try to add, even when we try to bring ourselves into Christ, it's accursed. And I'm going to give you these scriptures right here. Deuteronomy 7 and 26. We'll probably go back over these some more next week. 7 and 26. Neither shalt thou bring an abomination into thine house, lest thou be a cursed thing like it. But thou shalt utterly detest it, and thou shalt utterly abhor it, for it is a cursed thing. You know, I just think what Paul says, forgetting those things that are behind. Don't bring any of that into the house. Remember, we talk about what those are, the lust. Now, go with me to Joshua 6 and 18. And ye in any wise keep yourself from the accursed thing, lest ye make yourselves accursed. When ye take of the accursed thing, when you touch it, when you grab a hold of it, when you set your lust there, and make the camp of Israel accursed, and trouble it. Paul said, I know these people are coming here, they trouble you. Here's how they brought in the accursed thing. Look at Joshua 7 and 12. Therefore the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies. Remember, he said that they might be established. Stand in the liberty. But now he says the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their backs before their enemies because they were accursed. Neither will I be with you anymore, except ye destroy the cursed thing from among you. How was that in Paul? I am crucified. There was the accursed thing. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. He lives. How can I bring myself or allow you to be brought back into this thing? See, Paul didn't destroy it. He faced the destruction of it. It's a soul that says, I am crucified with Christ. And here, look, let me give you these verses right here. Joshua 7 and 13, he says, up, sanctify the people and say, sanctify yourselves against tomorrow. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, there is an accursed thing in the midst of thee. O Israel, thou cannot stand before thine enemies until ye take away the accursed thing from among you. In other words, you can never experience the salvation you've been brought into. You can never experience the rest that you've been brought into until the accursed thing is gone. And these people were bringing in the accursed thing, calling it another gospel. Now here's the thing that got me in Joshua 7 and 11. Israel has sinned. They have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have even taken of the accursed thing, and have also stolen, and disassembled also. They have put it even among their own stuff. You see how this got assimilated right into our religion and our doctrine so easily? And we didn't even think nothing about it. But yet God is calling it a cursed thing because we're here under the lust of the flesh trying to get God to make me this and to do this and to help me this and fulfill my destiny. And the whole time we're trampling underfoot the blood of Jesus Christ. Not even knowing that we're doing it. We're trying to usurp Him and get Him off the throne so I can sit there and make God happy. We think God sending His sons here, His sole purpose was to make me rich. God sent His son here so that I could be rich and famous. I mean, that's the Christian world out there, guys. You know it and I know it. But see, Paul faced all this in the revealing of Christ. You know what Paul faced? Paul faced the end of one creation. In Revelation it says he faced the rolling up of the scroll. He faced the rolling up and the whole thing gone away. And he faced all things new in Christ Jesus. And Paul, now you see in Paul's heart with his letters that he was writing to these people and how what we think is small of what Paul says, anything outside of Christ is an abomination. It is a curse. Let it be a curse. Do not try to bring any of that stuff in. Do not try to do it. Do not try to be anything for God. Let Christ be your all in all. All right.